I would just like to echo the acknowledgement that we are gathering this afternoon on Darkinjung country, unceded land with 65,000 years history of art, culture and storytelling, as well as thousands of years of land care. I too pay my respects to elders past and present and wish to warmly welcome any First Nations audience members who may be here with us this afternoon. So I'm Sam Twyford-Moore. I'm the author of The Rapids and manager of the Faber Writing Academy at Allen and Unwin. And it's my great pleasure to introduce these three incredible authors to you today. I'll start by introducing them one by one, and they will then give a short reading from their works, which are sitting up here. And they've chosen some words that best represent the themes of today's panel and give you a sense of their books. The idea of the panel this afternoon is to look into the climate crisis via some extraordinary writing of both fiction and non-fiction. It's obviously not a comfortable topic, but the only way through this period of history seems to be to acknowledge and act on our discomfort. In the words of the festival, we acknowledge that climate change has arrived alongside its sombre partner, climate grief. The question the programmers have set for us today is, how do we mourn the disappearing world? I will start with introducing Lucy, who's to my left. Lucy is the award-winning author of Salt Creek, which was shortlisted for the Miles Franklin Literary Award, and like one of our other panelists, is a winner of an Indie Book Award. She is the author most recently of the book that we will be speaking about today, Wolfe Island, and her essays and short stories have appeared in the Saturday paper, Meanjin, and Best Australian Stories, among others. Lucy joins us from Melbourne, where she's currently writing her third novel. Please join me in welcoming Lucy.
I'm just going to read a little bit from Wolfe Island. Kitty is the protagonist and she lives on this island on her own, almost on her own. Summertime. When I wake early, I can pretend things haven't changed. I wait for this moment, first light arriving on the plain of Wolfe Island, like a can of paint-washed water of clearest watermelon pink flung in enormous, delicate rush. I go out to the garden, adjust the shades to suit the forecast, do some pollinating, throw some water around, wonder about the failures to thrive and think possibilities and adjustments. I make coffee and watch the world and listen too before people obliterate the sounds. A day or two ago, girl and I rambled the nearby shore, she sniffing and me poking around for what might have washed up. A sick bird or an old packing case or plastic from a long way off with lettering on it I couldn't understand. Then I went to my makings room and its long benches, touching things, holding them, not thinking anything in particular, moving things about, seeing how they might create together. I went out and picked a few flowers, took one from the bunch and laid it down alongside a spoon, and then inside the spoon, as if I'd been fishing for flowers with it. And look at this one that came up, chicory, almost blue and almost purple. What would I make a flower out of? I had a piece of hammered blue tin that might work. Oh, believe me, it would be exciting stuff to watch. Slow air came through the window and the sound of a bird. The air turned ponderous and hot. I sprayed garlic about my yard to keep the mosquitoes down and mowed the verges of the road between my house and Shipley's. The lawnmower fumes made a blue haze in the air. Pomegranates hung in the trees. Butterflies flickered. The marshes were as beautiful as I ever saw them, speckled with pink mallows and banks of snowy marsh hibiscus, their buds unfurling and shriveling within a day. And the orange trumpet flower vines and the honeysuckle scrambled and hung from every building, scenting the heavy air until every bit of it was sweet. Despite that old beauty, I began seeing things, signs or occurrences that gave me pause. It was as if a deep breath had been drawn, as if it might be needed for a race or a deep dive, and we were waiting. I began a list. Recent observations. Alejandra would have eaten handfuls of pokeberries one hot afternoon if I hadn't banged on the study window and shouted. The poor girl jumped and the berries tumbled about her. Everything about the livid colours and fleshy stems of pokeberry bushes screamed poison to me, but Alejandra was as helpless as a baby where nature was concerned. What else might she do? The stump of Wolfe's pine washed free in a storm, roots and all, and there was nothing to take its place. My mother said there must always be a pine on Pine Point and a young pine coming through. But the young pine had died of salt already, and the point has already begun falling apart. It's bad luck to kill a summer goose. Who doesn't know that? I couldn't believe it when I saw Josh stalking them in the North Marshes with a hunting rifle one morning. Girl and I went out. I hollered and called to Girl just to kick up a noise and even sang snatches of song. Girl barked in a cooperative spirit. The geese exploded into the air, almost vertical in their haste. Alejandra found a dead bird in the berry patch. She pressed a strawberry to its beak, but it did not wake, so she stroked its head. An adult passes a dead bird and they kick it aside. A child makes a coffin nest filled with soft things and berries, a crust of bread, and puts soft old cloth, a silk scarf, say, as a lid on top to stop the dirt falling on its sightless eyes, so it continues its deep and pleasant sleep. They are kind to creatures in death, even if cruel to them sometimes in life. I began looking at the sky and the clouds, the shape of the waves, and the direction of birds' flight, how they had all changed, and wondered what they meant. I knew how they felt. My direction had changed too. If I were as superstitious as my mother, I might have paid more attention to things that were happening. But it wasn't until I considered my list that I understood its meaning. Bad things were coming.
Thanks, Lucy. To Lucy's left is Delia Falconer, the author of the novels The Service of Clouds and The Lost Thoughts of Soldiers. She's also the author of the non-fiction collection Sydney, a personal history of her hometown, and more recently, Signs and Wonders, Dispatches from a Time of Beauty and Loss, which was published in September last year. Please join me in welcoming Delia.
Thank you. I have a nest in a little section I'm going to read as well. I'm just going to read a truncated section of the introduction to my book. A few years ago, I found a bird's nest on the footpath, a beautiful thing of loosely woven she-oak needles lined with pale grey fur. I held it cupped in my hand as I continued onto the train from our inner city suburb and walked through the long pedestrian tunnel to the edge of Sydney's central business district. The joyful attention it attracted surprised me. "That's a little noisy miner's nest you've got there," a woman told me as she passed. "Lovely," another called out. But when I reached the university and showed it to my student, a man my own age, his face fell. "This meant a bird had lost its home," he said. "Did I know," he asked, "that when the harbour bridge was first built, crows made their nests on its high trusses? But when they went out to search for food, the architecture was so repetitive that even these clever birds couldn't find their way back to their chicks." I smiled a little to myself at my student's tragic cast of mind. Recent high winds had blown down this nest, a small drama innocent, as far as I knew, of any human interference. Yet I was all too familiar myself with a sense of wonder that flipped quickly into apprehension about our impact on the natural world. Were the still evenings of a gloriously prolonged summer reason to rejoice, or evidence of disrupted climate patterns? Was it great good fortune, while driving in a remote part of the country, to have seen a koala bundling along by the roadside with her joey on her back, or an indicator of distress? Over the last few years, these trains of thought have multiplied. Is what I am witnessing normal or abnormal, a good or a bad sign? And above all, is it due somehow to us? These days, the most beautiful things, whose perennial loveliness once sustained us, carry the weight of an apprehension that has come upon us with terrifying speed. Could it have only been 2014 that I first heard the word Anthropocene? which denotes the astonishing concept that we've entered a new human-made geological epoch, that our signature will persist, stamped into the Earth's strata, for longer than it's possible to imagine. Though the term is contentious, there's broad scientific consensus that our activities have acquired the geological force to push the atmosphere, geology, hydrology, and other processes of this 12,000-year-old epoch out of their predictable patterns and variability. Such knowledge brings its own vertigo as we try to reconcile such dire warnings with our ongoing daily life. And yet the world seems more beautiful than ever to me these days, more intensely lovely, as if these qualities were also undergoing an exponential feedback effect. It is often sublimely beautiful in the classical sense of exciting emotions and thoughts beyond the ordinary. On any given day, a fleeting cabinet of wonders passes through my phone. Ancient tardigrades or water bears under intense 3D magnification, like pouchy little taxidermist's armatures, come to life, which can survive freezing, radiation, or the blast of a supernova. The warped green beams of the Aurora Australis, the flight of a hummingbird caught in slow motion, a dinosaur tail the size of a sparrow's with chestnut feathers preserved in amber. More recently, there's been the disconcerting vision of some of the world's most polluted cities, Delhi, Bangkok, Bogota, Sao Paulo, their skies transformed in the midst of the human suffering of pandemic lockdowns from smog to a lambent blue. It's as if our feeds have become our prosthetic heightened senses, allowing us to see, even if only casually, the uncanny beauty in everything. To confront the epic scale of these events can feel paradoxically as if we've been plunged back in time, out of a scientific era and into an age of myth and wonder. For as they come under more threat, we're also learning more almost daily about the fantastic complexity of our ecosystems and the miraculous self-balancing of our Earth's fragile atmosphere. Sometimes, as if in a fairy tale, it seems that as science discovers more about the world's intricate agency, we are seeing everything we intuited as children now coming true, that a solitary tree in a paddock feels lonely, that the winds are alive, that animals talk, that fish feel pain. All things counter, original, spare, strange, wrote Victorian poet Gerard Manley Hopkins in his celebration of pied beauty. Whatever is fickle, freckled, who knows how? As my student intuited, in the face of such enormity, even a humble bird's nest can become an almost unbearably poignant and vivid object.
Thank you. And at the end of the panel, we have Charlotte McConaghy, who is the author of Migrations, a Time magazine best book of the year, and which is being translated into over 20 languages and adapted for film. Her latest book is the New York Times bestseller, Once There Were Wolves, winner of the Indie Book Award for Fiction 2022. Charlotte has both a graduate degree in screenwriting and a master's degree in screen arts and lives in Sydney, where she joins us from today. Please join me in welcoming Charlotte.
Thank you. Thanks, Sam. It's a bit tricky to find a section that's sort of specifically about the theme, so I'm just going to read from the very start of the book and first couple of pages. When we were eight, Dad cut me open from throat to stomach. In a forest in the wilds of British Columbia sat his workshop, dusty and reeking of blood. He had skins hanging to dry and they brushed our foreheads as we crept through them. I shivered even then, while Aggie grinned devilishly ahead of me, bolder than me by far. After summers spent wishing to know what happened in their shed, I was suddenly desperate to be gone from it. He'd caught a rabbit, and though he'd let us stalk the woods with him, he'd never shown us the act of killing. Aggie was eager, and in her haste she kicked a brine barrel, her foot making a deep, echoing thud, one I felt on my foot too. Dad looked up and sighed. "You really want to see?" Aggie nodded. "Are you prepared for it?" Another nod. I could see the furry rabbit and all the blades. It wasn't moving, dead already. "Come on over then." We went to either side of him, our noses peeking over his workbench. From here I could see all the fine colours of its pelt, russet browns and dusky oranges, warm creams and greys and whites and blacks, a kaleidoscope of colour, all designed, I supposed, to make it invisible and prevent this exact fate. Poor rabbit. Do you understand why I'm doing this? Dad asked us. We both nodded. Subsistence living, Aggie said. Which means, Inti, we hunt only what we need and we give back to the ecosystem. We grow food too. We live as self-sufficiently as we can, I said. That's right, so we pay our respects to this creature and thank it for sustaining us. Thank you, Aggie and I chimed. I had the feeling the rabbit could have cared less about our gratitude. Silently, I bitted a glum apology, but all the while something was tingling in my belly, right down at the bottom of it. I wanted to get out of there. This was Dad's realm, the furs and the blades and the blood, the smell he was always draped in. It had always been his realm, and I wished it could stay that way. This felt like the opening of a door to a darker place, a crueler one, an adult one. And I didn't know why she wanted this, but if she did want it, then I had to stay. Where Aggie went, I followed. Before we eat it, we have to skin it. I'll cure the pelt so we can use it or trade it, and then we'll eat every part of the carcass so there's no waste, we answered. And why is that? Waste is the true enemy of the planet, we said. Come on, Dad, Aggie complained. All right, first we cut from throat to stomach. The tip of his blade went to the fur of the rabbit's throat, and I knew I'd made a mistake. Before I could slam my eyes shut, the knife opened my throat and sliced my skin in one long, swift motion to my tummy. I hit the floor hard, cut open and spilling. It felt so real, I was sure there must be blood, and I screamed and screamed, and Dad was shouting now too, and the knife dropped, and Aggie dropped, and she pulled me tight against her, her heartbeat pressed to mine, her fingers drumming a rhythm against my spine, and in her skinny arms I was intact again, myself with no blood, and never in fact a wound at all. I had always known there was something different about me, but that was the day I first recognised it to be dangerous. It was also the day, as I stumbled out of the shed into a long, violent dusk, that I looked to the tree's edge and saw my first wolf, and it saw me.
Wow. These wonderful readings have lined up perfectly with my first question, and I want to begin by talking about animals, because while all three books about humanity's impact on landscape and nature, they're also very concerned about the lives of animals in the age of the climate crisis. And it seems that non-human creatures are being hit hardest and first. Lucy and Charlotte, there are really extraordinary similarities between your novels. They are both about willful yet compassionate protagonists who in one form or another care for wolves. They both feature anxieties around pregnancy, both of the human and the animal kind, and they both don't shy away from animal cruelty within their plots. Charlotte, I'll start with you. In his wonderful non-fiction account of Wolves and Men, the late Barry Lopez wrote that the wolf exerts a powerful influence on the human imagination. It takes your stare and turns it back on you. How did you come to submit yourself to the influence of wolves?
Great question. Okay, so I was reading widely, trying to come up with a storyline for a book, and I came across the story of Pando the Trembling Giant, which is this extraordinary, enormous organism in America. It's a forest of quaking aspen trees, but it's not actually a forest, it's one tree, and it's thousands of shoots that are all connected to this extraordinary big underground root system. It's, scientists think it could be a million years old, so it's amazing. It's also the heaviest organism on the planet, but it's dying because of human impact, like so many things. But there's a really elegant solution to saving this beautiful forest, and that's to reintroduce wolves, which had been hunted to extinction in that area. But of course, that's not going to happen because human interests are very entrenched and there's a lot of pushback from the locals there. But this led me to kind of become fascinated with wolves and very curious as to how they could possibly save a forest. And it's because wolves are a keystone species, which means they have trickle-down effects on every other living thing in their environment, from insects to mammals to birds. They affect the water tables and therefore can change the course of rivers, and they regrow forests. And not only are they essential to their ecosystems, they're incredibly misunderstood creatures, and this was what I found most fascinating. We need them so desperately, and yet we've painted them throughout our history as the monsters in all of our stories, when in fact, wolves are gentle, shy, family-oriented creatures. And so this was, it was just very fascinating to me, this real kind of disconnect between the truth of what they are and what we had made them into. And so I just felt like this was a kind of an amazing, rich place to start for a story.
No, fantastic. Lucy, one of the key characters in your book is a wolf dog called Girl. I'm wondering how you came about to write about that particular crossbreed of canine.
Well, partly I think one of the things that happens with me in writing is that as soon as I know what kind of dog a character has, I know that person really well, very quickly. And the whole wolf element that it reverberates through this book began with a search for the name of this particular island, and I delved around through lots of different islands in the area. One of them is called Goat Island, and I could see immediately that a book called Goat Island probably wouldn't sell very well. And I came across a Fox Island, and I thought, oh yeah, that's getting closer. And then I thought of Wolf. I thought, aha, that's it, that's Wolf. And that began to feed into the development of character, not only the protagonist, Kitty Hawk, but also to the sorts of things that she did, that she was interested in, the ways that she behaved. And so then I did a lot of research. I could see that she couldn't have a pet wolf. She had to have a dog of some description. So I made it a wolf dog. And these are hybrid animals that are pretty popular in the United States, and they're actually trying very hard to eradicate them. They're very dangerous, unstable family pets. But
they're outlawed in Australia,
yeah,
right?
They are, that's right. There is a kind of pretend wolf dog looking dog that they've invented for Australia. It was to me an expression of Kitty's essential nature, which is part wild and part tame, and of the island being part civilized and part falling into ruin. So it was an expression of the liminal states, I suppose, of a lot of things in that book.
Brilliant. This is unfortunately my bleakest question. Unfortunately, it's for you, Delia, but I feel like your book handles bleakness really well. So obviously the black summer megafires beginning in the winter of 2019 seem to be this terrible crystallising of our future in the present moment. And it also felt like a moment that we didn't get to unpack because COVID hit us so soon after. One of the things that remained unreckoned with was the death toll of animals in the fire. In your diary, Terror from the Air, which really is a very important record of that time, in one entry you note that up to 3 billion animals were potentially killed in that season, up to 2.5 billion reptiles alone. Can you talk about what it is like to sit at a writing desk and reckon with such grim statistics and how you can possibly start to unpack them?
Just thinking that Patrick White once wrote in a letter to someone, yet again I was the skeleton at the Great Australian Feast, and thanks for that question, so I can... there are very grim statistics in this book, and... That count of the number of animals that were killed in the megafires of 2019 to 20 was actually the first time that we've ever counted animal casualties. You know, what does that say about us? Tom Griffiths, the wonderful environmental historian, points that out. So that is, I think, that says something about our, our lateness as colonial, from those of us who come from colonial cultures, to really reckon with, the fact that, animals and us are, part of the, are sort of strongly related, and that they, we need to care for them, and that they're, complex, complex environments are important. But, so I didn't want to... And I think that... So what I'm trying to look at in this book is, one of the things that fascinated me, thinking about the animal question again, was just that we've kind of put ourselves in a position in coming to this knowledge very late of having a horrible sort of responsibility placed on our shoulders. So I was thinking, in my book I write about Willie Smits, who's who runs the Borneo Orangutan Foundation, and in order to save those orangutans, they've actually had to try and reseed rainforest, use NASA satellite technology to look at the illegal felling of trees outside of where they're supposed to be felled. They have had to find fairer trading deals with local Dayak people, and so on. And so there's this awful kind of responsibility that comes with this. So I'm sort of interested really thinking about where we are now. But when it comes to those statistics, I think that they can really, it seems almost unreal, even if you've sat in Sydney and you've felt that smoke and lived in and read the reports of beekeepers going into the older beekeepers going into the bush first to because of the crying animals in the bush, so that the young people wouldn't have to, young beekeepers wouldn't have to hear that. I think that we need to hold on to those smaller sort of details. So one of my main aims with the book was to try and bring things down to constantly to sort of play between the enormity of these statistics that just hit us one after the other, IPCC reports and so on, and that particularly awful statistic, and then sort of really try to record the small details like that around the beekeepers, or the fact that, what it felt like, and what sort of emotions, how can we find a language that's commensurate for that? And I found that the only way I could do it was to sort of take my own life. It sort of sits, I'm sort of about the same age as the Great Acceleration, where we start the last 50 years has really been when we've done the most damage to sort of 70% of animals on the planet, wild animals we've wiped out, and so on, and really just to sort of try and sort of bring those statistics close and then look at them from afar, bring them close and take them afar. So, it was, I have to say, it was that fire diary was the hardest part of the book to write. And every time I would put off coming back to editing that, because it was a hard territory to enter, and it was a pretty tough space to sit in for a couple of years writing the book. But we can't leave that space. It's not like we can. Not like it's sort of those things are going away if we don't look at them and sit with them. And I wanted to just sit quietly as things accelerate around us with. And take different sort of perspectives through the current moment.
I just remember when the book came out and reading that and just thinking, I can't believe you actually finished, that this is a project that you could finish, I suppose. You've touched a little bit about on some restorative measures. Charlotte, you recently said at a writers' festival that I think Delia was actually chairing, that you wanted to write this book less as a warning, more of writing from a place of solutions. Can you talk a bit about the concept of rewilding that is really central to the plot of this book?
Yeah, sure. So, that statement was in reference to, I guess, the differences between my first novel, Migrations, and this book, Once the Wolves. And Migrations came from a place of loss and grief. And as Delia mentioned, it was trying to look at, it's set in the very near future during the peak of the extinction crisis, so most of the animals on the planet are gone in this novel. And so it was trying to look at the enormity of the loss of that, and then also look at the kind of personal grief of this character to make it feel real. Whereas Once There Were Wolves, I think I shifted away from wanting to sit in sadness and grief about what we'd lost and more into a space of rallying for the fight. being active and writing about an active protagonist who's trying to solve something and trying to fight against something instead of just mourning. This book is about one such aspect of the fight, which is rewilding, and which I think sort of means reclaiming spaces that humans have changed and returning them to their kind of wild former selves. So it's set in Scotland, which is, it's funny, Scotland, we kind of all know it as this place of rolling hills dotted with sheep and bleak, moody moors, and it's really beautiful in that way, but it wasn't that. It was actually covered in really rich, wild forest until the day came when humans started to hunt the wolves there. Well, this is one element of what got rid of the forests, is killing all the wolves affected the ecosystem so badly that all the forests are dying off, and so and this is happening everywhere, all over the world. It's not a specific to Scotland. We're doing it here. Deforestation is a staggering issue. So I was just really interested in how we return spaces to what they once were, and the idea that maybe all we need to do is release something that was once there and let it do the job for us. Wolves do this job for us. Dingoes do it here. Maybe it's about kind of becoming less involved in this world and stepping back and letting it kind of recover.
Mm, totally. Lucy, your book came out in 2019 before the kind of extremities that we've been through in the last few years, but in a way, your novel is, you know, has this powerful sense of mourning within it, and the sense of this island sinking into the sea feels like the end of the line in some ways. I'm wondering if you can talk a bit about the language that you stumbled onto to tell that particular story and getting the tone of grief and hope right.
Sure. It was a part of my answer to this. Relates to the research that I did. And I started writing when I was feeling this terrible weight of sadness. You know, that you just feel it's unbearable. What do you do with it? And I came across this picture of a single house on this tiny scrap of land in the middle of the Chesapeake Bay. And that's all there was. There's a little red bulldozer pulled up to the door. That's like the family car, and that just kind of pushes up these ramparts of dirt. And that island disappeared in 2011, and that was not the first of the islands in this bay that had disappeared. And the way people on this in this whole bay talk about it is that it's always been a changeable landscape, but they're not recognising that kind of the acceleration of land loss that's happening. But I went there and did a couple of quite long research trips and chatted to people in that way that you let yourself do when you're a writer. And I was really surprised that instead of feeling this huge sadness, they were all like, yeah, well, it's always been changeable, and yep, we've just got to build a new pier, and yep, we have to jack the house up on hydraulics and move it back from the road a bit, and shame that the playground in the school has drowned, but what can you do? These things happen. And it was just their matter-of-fact resilience about it that really struck me. And I met these two fantastic scientists who, when I asked what they thought about things, said, oh, well, I think we're all right, aren't we? But the town they live in has just had one in 100-year floods in the space of 7 years. I don't know what's happening, they said. I said, do you think it could be climate change? And they went, huh, you think? I was just like, maybe she's right. So I was caught between my own terrible grief and then seeing their extreme practicality, the way they just picked up and moved. And if all of the land was lost, they just went and, you know, they would just pop their house on a boat or pontoons, carve it up, take it off to the mainland, get a bit of land there. And on they went with life in this really tough, very admirable way. They're all Trump voters, obviously. They're all like, it's God's way. So I was caught between those two things, I think, that wanting to express my own grief, but wanting to also point out that these people are not down and out. But the other thing is that this is a country that's got quite a bit of land still around, and there are plenty of countries, like the islands of the South Pacific, they can't just move their houses. So I think it was this, wanting to express that loss, the sadness through the music of language, and wanting to point the other out.
I think one of the hard things about that grief is that we're paying it forward in a way, and I think climate change is forcing humanity to confront generational legacies like it never has before. You know, the platitude, I just want to leave the world a better place for my grandchildren, is starting to sound frankly delusional. Delia, this intergenerational debt is something that you've written about from a non-fiction perspective with great honesty and clarity in Signs and Wonders. Your children were born in 2011. They are present throughout the book. And as your son notes, they have already lived through two of the biggest events of their parents' five-plus decade lives, namely the Black Summer Fires and the pandemic. What was it like to reckon with this legacy within the book?
Oh, look, you know, everything is moving so incredibly swiftly. That's part of the problem, I think, for all of us sort of writing in this space, that I think when I started thinking about this book, which was probably about 2018, that the IPCC report at that stage said we had 12 years to really sort of turn things around before we were kind of locked into global heating. You know, perspective, we're seeing all this sort of stuff happening at 1.1 degrees of heating now. We're on a trajectory at present to about 2.7 degrees of warming by century's end, but we could be looking at sort of four or so, you know, just depending on which sort of way we go. And by the time I'd sort of finished writing this book, I think the latest reports are saying that, you know, we're looking really at months at the moment to really be starting to commit to renewables, to just radically get rid of our dependence on coal. So that, sitting with that sort of knowledge and seeing those things while writing with, you know, beautiful 10-year-old twins.
From a fictional perspective, Lucy, Kitty Hawk is your protagonist. She's a no-nonsense woman who carries around a gun and isn't afraid to use it. She's also a grandmother, and I thrill at the idea of grandmothers in literature. I just think they're the most interesting people alive, so more first-person protagonist grandmothers, please. Can you talk about conceptualising this character and that same question about, you know, how she reckons with the legacies of climate change and passing on these landscapes?
Yeah, Kitty's... She's a ferocious person, I think, is how I think of her. And when I pictured her first, I saw her standing in the top of this White House, the one that was on the disintegrating island, looking out in this kind of fury, wondering what had happened. And everything developed from that moment. But the thought of... The thought of her and all that she's seen is this kind of trajectory that carried me through. What was her life on this island like that, you know, her family had been living on for 400 or 500 years, possibly longer? Just trying to work out what had happened and what could she do to stem things. And I guess she did the things that we all do, her equivalent of putting the plastic in the recycling. So what she did was... if there was a kind of breach in some of the walls, she would just go and shore it up with a bit of dirt and rock, and she just she sort of patrols the island, trying to look after it. She's the custodian of this island, but I also wanted her to have that sort of practicality that the people there did have. So she's fierce. She hates what's happening. She will miss it. There's this loss built into everything that she does. But there is this immense practicality about her approach that there's no point in just sitting around saying, oh, no, it's very sad, poor island. But, you know, I've got to save these people who I love. What am I going to do? And it's a little bit like what you were saying, Charlotte, that it's moving past the sorrow to the saving. What do you do in that? You know, how do you act in those situations. And I think, you know, during the fires a few years ago, I remember standing at the front gate thinking, okay, fires are not here, but what are we going to do? Like, where are we going to go? And our children were sitting around one day at a family dinner saying, I've got it sorted out. That's it. We're all going to South Australia. And then South Australia started burning and they're like, next plan. But, you know, that we all started planning for disaster. I was so aware of disaster sort of coming from so many different directions. Yeah.
Yeah, totally. I think there's a lot of Kitty Hawk that we could take with us and would be of use.
But not the county.
I think that, you know, like obviously all of this, and you know, this conversation alone can be quite overwhelming, but I did want to talk about the idea of story and the importance of imagination and story during this time. There's a moment, Charlotte, where you look up from reading your wonderful novel and you kind of realise you're reading this stunning piece of genre writing in a way, this incredible high wire act that's almost a psychological thriller housed within this wider ecological canvas. Again, to go back to a recent quote of yours, you sort of said, the presence of climate change needs to exist in all of our stories. It shouldn't be confined to genre. It can be in murder mysteries, romance novels, crime novels. I'm wondering if you can talk a bit about that in terms of writing your two books.
Yeah, so, I mean, I guess I've always got a rule for myself, which probably most writers do, but the rule is I always write the book that I want to read, and which means that I write about what I am passionate about. At the moment, that's climate. I didn't originally set out to write about climate change. I wanted to write a book about nature and our connection to nature and how nourishing and healing that can be. And I just found that I kept coming up against our impact on nature and I couldn't ignore that. And so what in Migrations, what had started out as an epic character journey also became a look at what we've done to the world and how we survive that. Once There Were Wolves is similar in that it's about climate change, but it's also about all the things that I love in stories. It's about murder mysteries and love stories and stories of sisters, family, the complicated idea of becoming a mother. There's a lot going on, and I think that's just because I feel like sometimes it's better to, maybe it's like hiding the lesson behind the fun. I want to enjoy the things that I'm reading. I really want to kind of get sucked into a fantastic story, and then I want to be hit in the guts by its message. And so I will always kind of go for story first, character first, and use this kind of wider thematic of what we've done to the world, to the natural world, as support for that character journey and the way that I can sort of play with genre and include as much as I can.
Yeah, amazing. Delia, your book is, you know, there's a lot of environmental focus, but there's also these incredible literary essays that feel like they've been, you know, collected from, a bit of time. Some of them touch on September 11th, 2001. I'm wondering, you know, September 11th and then, you know, the 20 years of great literature as well. I'm wondering how those essays came to sit side by side and whether they speak to those environmental essays, that kind of history of reading that's so present in the book.
Yeah, well, I also wanted to write a book that was the sort of book that I would like to read as a reader. And what I wanted was a book that sort of put together what was around in terms of philosophy, science, you know, and fiction and great non-fiction, and sort of think about how, you know, what's happening in this moment is that it's become sort of predictably unpredictable. Things are going off scale. You know, we are looking at, just have to look at the last few years. Things are are out of whack in ways that are, we are looking at sudden changes, not the kind of the gradualism that we've, and that's a big problem for us. I think we have to expand our imaginations to, and our feelings to encompass the fact of things being so sort of radically unstable and, out of joint. And so as I was starting to write these essays, I was thinking about, I was really interested in that idea of just how are we able to, or we've almost got to, you know, we've become humans in a stable sort of system. We've become, you know, we learn about language through animals. We understand ourselves through seasons and all those sort of elements that have been part of the foundations of our sort of storytelling and our feelings about the world are all, again, so sort of unstable. So I started to think, well, how are novelists writing about that, you know, which of course is also how can I write about this when I go back to fiction. And, you know, one of the things that I think is so interesting about your novel, Charlotte, is the way that you capture the emotional intensity of this sort of time so well. And so I was really interested. I think it's around about 2000, which for many of us we sort of date, you know, back to the fall of the Twin Towers, when, novels start to become really sort of fascinating and unstable, and you start to get novels like, you know, novels like Jonathan Franzen trying to write these big unwieldy books that have essays, you know, bits of essays in them and sort of all encompassing or, you know, sort of novels that are a bit sort of, kind of mad, you know, sort of bit, sort of magic realist elements and so on. And it's sort of part of this, I think, this great sort of reckoning that we've actually been kind of going through in film and in literature, as well as in, you know, the science and the philosophy and so on that I also write about in the book. And it's all about this sort of trying to expand our imaginations and our feelings to, and I'm sort of, guess that's what I'm trying to do in this book as well, is to try and sort of expand my range of emotion and feeling through. So the essay, and I just want to have a variety of essays too, because when you read about this sort of stuff, you can feel like you're just again being sort of, you know, sort of pounded into the ground. I thought, well, I actually want to have some essays that, you know, about taking my kids to Canberra and looking for a Carboniferous fossil. Sean Prawn, if anyone else has also done this, you know, in Parliament House, in the marble, and using that as a way of thinking about coal and global heating, or talking about feeding the birds with my late mum and sort of expanding that out into thinking about how we're having to reckon with different levels of time, bird time, deep time, and so on. So I wanted to kind of take that's how the book has come, you know, to be quite varied, because I wanted to kind of take different core samples, if you like, through the moment that we're in.
Well, life still exists outside of, you know.
Yes,
this.
And capture the beauty as well.
Yeah.
And that was super important to me, because if you can't sort of love it and, you know, appreciate it and sit with what we have, then it's harder to think about saving it.
No,
and,
definitely.
And, you know, as my dear friend James Bradley, who's a wonderful novelist as well in this space and essayist, says, you know, to talk too much about apocalypse is giving up, you know. So you've got to kind of...
Exactly.
And I keep thinking about that, and you know, he also says children put a floor on your despair. So, I think that's really important too, to be talking about beauty as well.
No, exactly. Lucy, does that sense of expansion speak to you? There's a wonderful Tom Keneally gave a great quote for your book, saying it's an important literary fable of our period of history. Does the sense of fable or parable, you know, was that in your mind when you were writing this book, and that sense of expansiveness?
Yeah, I think partly when I was writing, I was trying to avoid putting Donald Trump in the book. So, but I also wanted to say something about exactly what that world is like now. And it's generally, I think people have come to think of climate fiction as something that is set in the future. So if it's climate fiction, it's all right. We don't need to worry too much. But I was saying, it's here right now. People are living this right now, you know, they've had to move from their islands. But I also think that beauty that you talk about is really important. And to say that even if climate change is all around us, the quotidian is all around us as well, that we're all living our lives. You know, I vividly remember this day during the bushfires when I went out to walk the dogs, and our street is very long and straight and it's sort of got high sides on it, and it looked like a canal filled with smoke. I couldn't see more than 100 metres or so. and the dogs were there, and we're sort of looking up and down the street going, hmm, and they gave me a look like, this is a situation, are we going to panic and run? That seems the course of action. And I said, no, it's okay, darlings. And then I thought, I must remember to get some bananas later, because I thought of the supermarket at the other end of the street. And we live these kind of dual experiences all the time, the kind of the horror of what's happening, the beauty of it. And it was incredibly beautiful, this canal of smoke and daily life plunging along.
I have so many more questions. You can't read three books like this and fit them into an hour and get through everything. But I have also been told that this is the best Writers Festival audience in the world and you have the best questions. So I have to hand over at some point. If anyone has a question for the panellists, there's a gentleman at the back and then a... The microphone's...
Yes, thank you. Thanks very much to all of you. First of all, that was very enlightening and a little bit disturbing perhaps, but that's the way things are. I received an email from the Nature Conservation Council this morning expressing optimism about the new government and the approach to endangered species and climate action and land clearing. And I suppose I wonder whether you shared that optimism. And I suppose I'm thinking back to an incident in the recent past where a public servant was murdered for investigating land clearing, and the then Deputy Prime Minister expressed his sympathy for the farmer who murdered him, and a lot of the community regarded him as being persecuted as well. So perhaps you could just talk to that. Are you optimistic, do you think, or do you think it's... Perhaps the problem's too immense, and we're a little bit too late.
Yeah. Look, my personal look. I'm not an optimist by nature. I certainly hope things are. I mean, surely they've got to take a turn for the better now. Surely with the change of government, one hopes. But you know, I always think of Samuel Beckett. You know, can't go on, must go on. That would be more my approach. But yes, of course, I think that this is I think what's been fantastic has been the grassroots campaigns for so many of the teals and the greens. And I believe that one of the reasons the greens did particularly well in Queensland was that they had spent about 2 years of working with local communities around issues of social justice and so on, because all these things go together, you know, treating people well, you know, I think goes with treating the world, the land well. So I think there's a tremendous amount of hope and small local, you know, local energy that's gone into this change of election result. And I would, you know, I think that it's a really good moment to grasp whether or not it's going to, you know, be successful, I don't know. But I think that we, you know, I certainly feel a renewed sense of possibility from, you know, community organisation. I think there's now an energy that we haven't had for some time in Australia, and I think that's a wonderful thing.
Yeah, I would definitely agree with that, and just say that it's very easy to feel pessimistic and apathetic, and I struggle with that. You know, I kind of go from one end of the spectrum to the other on any given day. But I don't think there's time for it. Like, we just don't have time to be pessimistic anymore. There's an urgency now where you've got to not let that in. It's too indulgent almost. I think we have to kind of, we've got to reach for the optimism, because that's what galvanises us. It's what energises us, and that's how we become active.
And there's a question in the blue over here. Microphone's just behind you.
Well, actually, that was very much the sort of the question that I was going to ask about hope. But having been through the depth of your feelings, I'm just wondering what sorts of responses there have been to your book, and where are you now compared to where you were before writing the book?
So, me?
Three of you.
Where am I now? Renewed sense of hope. Was that the first bit? The renewed, yeah. I think I didn't feel particularly hopeful at the time I wrote it, and I was writing out of this kind of deep sense of shock and that kind of concern that we all have, I think, about what kind of world that we're leaving behind. And honestly, until about 2 weeks ago, I just thought I will not be able to persevere. The depth of the horror that I felt at the government that we had, I'm sorry to be political, anyone wants to see that me being political, I'm a ranter on Twitter about politics. I think we have to feel some sense of hope that the government's changed. Could they be doing more? For sure. Would people go along with it? Probably not. So I think there's a kind of long game that's going on. I don't feel more hopeful because of the book I wrote. I feel more hopeful because maybe these many strands of concerned books have pulled together and been part of a collective voice that said, this is really terrible, I mean, beyond dreadful, and something has to happen. And I don't think a single book's going to do it, but I think a whole collection of voices calling for action has made a change, and I'm sure we're all incredibly proud to have been part of that. And I desperately hope that things can come of this. Whether it's enough and in time, I'm not sure. But the hope is there. Yeah.
Desperate hope, as you said.
Desperate, yes.
I think we're right on 2:30, so I assume that's time for us. I would just like to thank Words on the Waves for programming such a challenging conversation. I'm actually a Budgerowy boy, so to see a writers' festival in the Central Coast is very exciting. Clap. I never thought I'd hear a clap for a Budgerowy up this end of the coast, but that's good. Please join me in thanking Lucy, Delia, and Charlotte. Thank you.
Thanks, Sam.